We welcome you to the Tape Ministry of Denton Bible Church. The speaker today is the senior pastor, Tom Nelson.
Do you know how many revivals, how many sovereign moving of the Spirit of God occurrences took place in this country? Three of them. 1740, 1800, and the revival of 1858 that cast a lot of what is basic to us as Christians came out of these. And one of the great things that comes from revival is that of worship. You end up worshiping a God who redeems you and converts you. And some of the greatest of our hymns that you have sung and I have sung all of our lives have come out of these sovereign movings of God and these great revivals, 1720 to 1850. And I want Charles just to give us a little bit of what Christians in your day, our brothers and sisters, were listening to when these were happening. Charlie?
As Tom said, the 18th century is very key in the life of church music. In fact, the 18th century has become known as the golden age of hymns because of the virtual explosion of hymn writing during that period of time. And I really wanted to focus on five of the key writers of these hymns, great, great lyrics that have come from that time period. The first one is Isaac Watts, and he's been become known as the father of English hymnody because he really started the ball rolling there. As a young individual, he complained to his dad about the sad state of church music, and his dad, as most dads would say, well, if you can do any better, why don't you? And in fact, he did. And at the age of 20, he wrote his first hymn, and this guy was no slouch. He was a genius by every reckoning. He had studied Latin, French, Greek, and Hebrew by the age of 13. This guy was brilliant. He wrote a logic textbook that was used at Oxford, at Cambridge, at Harvard, and Yale. So not only did he bring exceptional intellect, but he got a passionate heart in his hymn writing there. He wrote over 700 hymns. You'll recognize Joy to the World, O God, Our Help in Ages Past, and this one right here, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. The next great hymn writer was John Newton. His mom prayed when he was very young that he had become a minister, but he rebelled against that and joined the Royal Navy. He didn't fit very well there, so he deserted ship and he was flogged and kicked out. And then he fled to a place where, in his own words, he could sin freely. And he ended up on the west coast of Africa involved in the slave trade. He was subsequently converted during a major storm at sea, and he became a very ardent crusader against slavery. He wrote 280 hymns, among which are Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken, and also America's favorite hymn, you know it, Amazing Grace. You know, the next one, probably William Cowper as an English literature writer. He was very famous for that. He was a lawyer by training, although he never practiced law. He sadly was plagued by mental illness his entire life. He suffered from paranoia, from depression, and also from an irrational fear that he'd been damned by God. And yet, at the encouragement of John Newton, he became a very outgoing minister to the poor and also a hymn writer for the prayer meetings that they were having there. And in fact, he wrote 68 hymns, among which is this one, There is a Fountain Filled with Blood Drawn from Emmanuel's Veins.
Thank you.
The next individual is Augustus Toplady. He was a colorful individual. He happened to be a priest in the Church of England, and he was a verbal, outspoken opponent of Charles and John Wesley. In fact, at one point, he referred to John Wesley as a tadpole in matters of divinity. And Charles Wesley, he responded in kind, and he said, he is the most rancorous hater of the gospel system. So they kind of duked it out back and forth. But in the meantime, they wrote some great hymns. Toplady wrote this one, Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me. And finally, we come to the most prolific of the hymn writers, Charles Wesley. He was the 18th child of Susanna and Samuel Wesley, and he wasn't the last child. So they really had a fruitful marriage. He was heavily involved in prison ministry at Newgate Prison, especially with regard to death sentence prisoners, because they were in a special need of the grace of God. He and his brother were very, very active field preachers. He wrote a colossal 8,989 hymns. He was constantly writing. He was so prolific, he had to have written at least 10 lines of verse every day for 50 years. He and his brother wrote and composed 56 collections of hymns over 53 years. In fact, one of them was published by Benjamin Franklin. You'll remember these titles, O 4,000 Tongues to Sing, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. All of these are well known to us. And finally, one of my favorites, Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Well, those are all out of the phenomena of revivals. When I say revival, what do you think of? The chances are you think of that which is defined in our present day as a revival, that it's a series of meetings, usually in the South, over about a week, where people come together and sing and get aroused in the areas of religion. You know what the original definition of a revival is? It's a theological term. From Psalm 85, revive us again, O Lord, that we might seek thee. A revival is a sovereign moving of the Spirit of God, unprovoked by anything but his own grace and mercy, whereby he invigorates his church and brings repentance within the walls of the church, and by the response of them of great prayer for the souls of men, that he brings an unwarranted collection of himself and in gathering of himself of the souls of lost men to such an extent that when that revival is over, in the years that it takes place, that it completely changes society. It turns the hands of sin back in a society. It changes it culturally, in the arts, in morals, education, everything. You and I have never seen a revival. You've probably been to them, but you've never seen one, and I haven't either. They are marvelous phenomena. Our country experienced three of them in the original days of this country. I think, this is my personal opinion as to what God was doing, when you back up and look at the United States, let me tell you what happened. That all through church history, you have had sinners and saints, the lost and the saved. And from 312 AD on, under the Roman Empire, lost men were still compelled by Christian morality because Christianity was one with the state, be it under Rome or under the Holy Roman Empire or later under the state churches of Europe, that you compelled men to believe. Well, from 1648, when you have the Westphalia Confession, as we studied, you have the phenomena of religious freedom. Now, if you were Spock on the planet Vulcan, a totally rational being, and you observed from 1648 and following, you would have said, this will be interesting to see what happens. What will lost men do who are not compelled under the laws of the state to resist heresy, to are not given the freedom to assert their own belief, and are kept under the morals and doctrine of the church? Well, from 1648, you have man taking a hard left turn, and the phenomena of deism. And as we keep watching, that turn from the late 1600s is going to get buttressed by liberal theology out of Europe, evolution under Charles Darwin, and pretty soon it's going to get so far off that you're going to get to where atheism becomes the chief belief of the day. And you come to the mess that we call the 20th century, where you can actually have entire worlds going to war with each other. This little country called the United States is almost like it is preserved from the late 1700s wanderings by these phenomena that are called revivals. God retards us in sin. He won't let us wander so far. That's why we have always been in this country about 50 years behind Europe as far as evils. And he has used this country as a marvelous place of Bibles, of publications, printing, preachers, and missions during this age before, I think, what is the last days. That's the phenomena of America. This one we're going to look at is called the Great Awakening. You can study in American history, and you may never study this phenomena. It goes from about 1720, and it crests in 1740, but it goes all the way really until 1750. Your note says 1740. That's really when it crests. The residue of this thing goes on all the way until the Revolutionary War. Now, let me show you what was happening in the colonies prior to the Revolution. You had a number of things. There were 18 different languages spoken along the Hudson River of European colonists because you could get land. People came here because they had something they could not have in England and in Europe, and that was land. You saw the phenomena of materialism begin. They would turn out tobacco, they would turn out cotton, they would send these back, and these people were beginning to prosper. You saw the phenomena of spiritual deadness in the Lutheran churches, the Presbyterian churches. One of the biggest messages that's going to be given during the Great Awakening, 1720 to 1740 and 50, is going to be the dangers of an unconverted ministry by Gilbert Tennant. You had lost men in these churches that were holding to great old confessions and creeds that had never been converted, preaching to a bunch of unconverted people. There's spiritual deadness. There's also the phenomena of the death of the Puritan dream. Those people that were the cutting edge of American history, the Puritans, from the late 1600s, they had lost their fervor. They had lost their, what you would call their standing in the community by the witch trials in Salem of 1690. The mania of 92, they called it. They had become infected by deism, and the Puritans are now in the denomination that is called Congregationalism. The Congregational Church now houses the old-time Puritans. Matter of fact, all the way down in Flower Mound, Texas, there is a Congregational Church that is called Mayflower Congregational, recalling their roots down there. And you saw the challenge of deism. In Harvard and in Yale, young men are nicknaming themselves Rousseau and Voltaire in scorn of Christianity. And so the foundations of the faith are coming under attack. The morality of America is wandering. Jonathan Edwards says there was an uncommon deadness of religion. And something's going to happen. Let me show you how it's going to happen. Can we flip one up there? There we go. The middle colonies in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, you're going to see a phenomena among a group of people called the Dutch Reformed and then among the Presbyterians. A particular fellow that I personally, when I heard about him in 1978 at Dallas Theological Seminary, I patterned most of my ministry after this fellow. He's a Presbyterian minister named William Tenet. We're going to see little winds begin to blow in Pennsylvania and in New Jersey. And then we're going to see the greatest of all theological Native American minds, Jonathan Edwards, begin to preach. And then down in Carolina and in Virginia and in Georgia, you're going to see laymen in rural communities begin what are called reading rooms. They're not preachers. They'll just get their hands on Pilgrim's Progress by Bunyan, Luther's Preface to Romans, and they'll have reading times. And a predominantly illiterate people will come from down south and listen to the gospel read. And they will have never heard it before. The Baptists are going to come into North Carolina and begin the phenomena of the Southern Baptist that will begin to spread. Let me just show you what happens in the middle colonies. You ready? I wish we had a picture of him. We couldn't find one. He sounds Dutch Reformed. You ever met a Dutch Reformed person? Chances are you go your whole life and you never meet one of these Calvinists that are out of Holland. Generally, when you meet them, they kind of congregate together. They're great, great dairy farmers. And you think that I'm Calvinistic. You had never heard Calvinism till you heard some of these guys preach. They are old Dutch or Holland Calvinists. And a whole big group of them gathered in the Raritan Valley of New Jersey. And they're so small. As a matter of fact, the only Dutch Reformed person I've ever met was the girl that had to pick me up in Ontario to give me a ride to the television station I was doing a show at. And her name was Sharon Vanderhoofen. And I said, "What is that?" She said, "Dutch Reformed." And I said, "Are you Calvinistic?" She said, "Yeah." She was. And they are an old Calvinistic branch. Well, there was a group of these Dutch immigrants. And they're so small that they have churches without pastors. And one fellow comes from Europe to pastor them. And he is a Dutch pietist. And to show you how great things begin with little people, I want you to imagine these little churches of 20 people stuck in this river valley of the Raritan River in New Jersey. And here this fellow, does he sound Dutch to you? Theodor Frelinghuysen. And he was a pietist, and he happened to believe that membership in a church did not save you, being raised Dutch Reformed did not save you, and reciting all the creeds did not save you. You must be born again. And this man began to go in the four churches along that valley that he would visit, and he began to call these religious people to repentance, and he saw the phenomena break out of people getting converted in the church. And do you know who got converted? The elders. The leaders of the churches were converted, and you think that's gossip material? Everybody began to talk now that these people had gotten converted. Well, New Jersey. Shortly after him, and here's one of my heroes. Could we get a picture of him? I don't think we could get William Tenet, did we? William Tenet, a Pennsylvania Presbyterian minister, moves to New Jersey, and there he's going to teach his sons. He doesn't want to send them to Harvard because it's liberal, and Yale is liberal. He doesn't want to send them back to England to go to school because it's too Romish and too Catholic in the Anglican Church. And so this fellow becomes a homeschooler. And he was mocked for doing it. And he puts his boys in this school that is called by his the people that held him in contempt. It's called the Log Cabin College. And we do have a picture of this. It became very famous. You know what the Log College is called today? Princeton. Let me tell you what this fellow did. William Tenet begins to teach these boys in Calvinistic biblical orthodoxy and apologetics. And he started about the time they were in 12, 13 years old. And he takes them all the way through high school. And he raises these boys in theology and piety and holiness. And then they become Presbyterian pastors, which was what he had hoped they would do. And they begin to itinerate there in New Jersey and in Pennsylvania in these small churches during the summer. And they begin to preach. Well, they started preaching like Mr. Tenet preached. He was a pietist. And they began to call men to repentance, and they became so vociferous that all of a sudden people within these confessing Presbyterian churches became born again. And the, now the scuttlebutt began all up and through New Jersey that confessing Presbyterians and Dutch Reformed people were being saved. These young men, they were called the Log Cabin College. You can trace them in American history. Some of them are on the Declaration of Independence. They were framers of the Constitution. They were presidents of universities. They were, some of them were doctors. They were lawyers. William Tennant became the greatest contributor to the, one of the greatest contributors to the history of our country by ongoing true biblical education. You'll find, incidentally, that a lot of great men in evangelism and pastoring, when they want to make the big impact, they end up in education, because that's where you truly, over the long term, change people. This is when I heard about what Tennant did when I was in seminary, I said, huh, I think that's the way to go. And so I began building onto my house and moving in men to disciple, and began the program that I have now. Between about 30 and 50 men a year move to Denton, and we train them four times a week for 9 months. No dating, no nothing, just pure misery under my program. And we disciple these men, and we have now had about 70 of them going to Dallas Seminary, and I don't know if they're going to be on the quality of William Tennant's Log College. But his that revival was so powerful that it split the church. Do you know that? In the Presbyterian church, they began seeing certain people that didn't like the way these men would preach, with passion and with power, without notes, and they became what was called old siders. You saw people that were for what they were doing that were called new siders, and they loved this kind of revival, and the Presbyterian church began to divide. New side, old side, Presbyterians that went for and against the revival. William Tennant, remember that name. So these winds begin to blow now. It's 1720, 1730. We go up now into Connecticut. This is called the greatest Native American theological mind that has ever lived. Went to Yale University at the age of 13. See what happens when you don't have TV? You learn amazing things. Began to teach at Yale by the time he is about 17 and 18. He is the grandson of one of the greatest of all Puritan preachers, Solomon Stoddard, a Puritan. He pastors in Northampton, Connecticut. He's an interesting fellow. He's about 6'4" in a day when men are pretty small. He marries this marvelous little bitty woman named Sarah Edwards, who later wrote a book called The Marriage to a Difficult Man, subtitled The Uncommon Union of Jonathan and Sarah Edwards. This man would eat five-minute meals. He would spend 14 hours in his study, and yet I think the two of them, they had 13 kids. And the funny thing was, there was a superstition in that day that your kid was born generally on the day he was conceived. And of his, I think, 13 kids, like nine of them were born on a Sunday. And so people looked askance at him as to his Sabbath keeping. But he would take his wife and child and children and face the congregation. That's where they sat when you would preach. And this fellow, he would emerge from his office, have quick meals. His wife was the life of the party. She made him what he was, basically. He would spend an hour with her every day, though, men. Every day he would stop what he was doing, and he and his wife would go horseback riding. And yet, ladies, to show you how consumed he was in the ministry, whenever he would go horseback riding, he would take little pieces of paper, and as he would have thoughts on the goodness of God, he would take those pieces of paper and he would pin them to his lapel. And so whenever he would finish, he would take off his coat, lay it down, covered with all this paper, he would take off and document all of his notes on the greatness of God. You can trace his children. I should have brought to you a narrative of what happened to his kids and grandkids and great-grandkids, but he and this woman became the greatest fountain for greatness in America simply by being a great father and a great husband. Well, in Northampton, Connecticut, he becomes very concerned with teenagers. The next generation, they were beginning to fall into drunkenness. They were doing what was called night walking. They would stay out late at night and just congregate, a bunch of teenagers. Sound familiar? They were doing what was called bundling. You know what bundling was? In the days when it would be cold and a boy and a girl would get together to visit, what they would do in the cold weather is they would go bundling. They would go to one of their bedrooms. Now, this was well thought of. You would do this. You would get into the bed, and you would cover yourself up with the sheets. And then you would take a big board, and you would put it between you so you couldn't touch. And it would go right up till your neck. And so you would lay on your back, and you would look at this girl from the neck up. And there you would lay in the bed, bundled in clothes, and you would visit. What do you think? Well, that's what they did in 1720 in Northampton. You ain't got a lot of choices in those days where you take a girl out, so you just bundle. And Mr. Edwards began to condemn that. That was wrong. Began to say that it shouldn't be. Began to cry out. Do you know what? These Christians became so concerned about their children. And whenever the Christians do this, you know that revival is coming. It doesn't bring revival. It is revival. You know what they began doing? These Christian parents began doing what was called prayer meetings because they were scared for their high school kids. And Christian parents would get together in homes and they would pray by name for their kids. They would seek God for that generation because these old-timers were from the 1600s and they could remember the days of the Puritan dream. They remembered tales of the Mayflower. And so they prayed for the greatness of God in their kids. And guess what? God began, just as he was moving in New Jersey, to move in those people's lives. A particular girl that was the bad girl of Northampton, kind of the Drew Barrymore of the Puritans, she became under such conviction that she came to Mr. Edwards. And Edward said she was under such conviction that she could barely articulate the estate of her soul, and he led her to faith. And it became so popular among teenagers that God had actually saved this girl, that she was seated, fully clothed, and in her right mind, just like the demoniac, that everybody had to come see it. And now high school kids started making appointments with Mr. Jonathan Edwards of Northampton to talk about the estate of their souls. And they saw so many kids trust Christ that all of a sudden it went into the adults. And he began to see now in the early 1740s, adults in Northampton begin to become converted. And Edwards began to challenge them on the estate of their souls, that just because they lived there, they were not converted. Matter of fact, he preached a message. I'm going to read to you just a tad. He preached it at Enfield, Connecticut, and it was so powerful that he wouldn't preach it anymore because the congregation had such violent response, such emotional response, that he had to stop what he was doing and calm these people down. It's one of the most famous sermons ever preached, and sadly enough, people always personify him as a screamer. This man was very quiet. He didn't raise his voice. He did not preach extemporaneous. He wrote his notes. He wore little glasses on his nose, and he would hold a candle where he could see. And he preached to this church of predominantly agricultural people there in Northampton, Connecticut, in Enfield, Connecticut. Have you ever heard of this message? What message are we talking about? Sinners in the hands of an angry God. I'm just going to read you an excerpt of what this man preached. And as he preached, he preached it first in his church, then he went to Enfield. Nothing happened in his church. At Enfield, he had to stop the service because everyone became so incredibly upset and weeping at what he was saying. This that you have heard is the case of every one of you that are out of Christ. That world of misery, that lake of burning brimstone, is extended abroad under you, and there is the dreadful pit of the glowing flames of the wrath of God. There is hell's wide gaping mouth open, and you have nothing to stand upon, nor anything to take hold of. There is nothing between you and hell but the air. 'Tis only the power and mere pleasure of God that holds you up. If God should withdraw his hand, they would avail no more to keep you from falling than the thin air to hold up a person that is suspended. Your wickedness makes you, as it were, heavy as lead, and to tend downwards with great weights and pressure towards hell. And if God should let you go, you would immediately sink and swiftly descend and plunge into that bottomless gulf. And your healthy constitution, your own care and prudence and best contrivance and all your righteousness would have no more influence to uphold you and keep you out of hell than a spider's web would have to hold a falling rock. Were it not that so is the sovereign pleasure of God, the earth would not bear you for a moment. For you are a burden to it. The creation groans with you. The creature is made subject to the bondage of your corruptions. And not willingly, the sun does not willingly shine upon you to give you light to serve sin and Satan. The earth does not willingly yield her increase to satisfy your lust, nor is it willingly a stage for your wickedness to be acted upon. The air does not willingly serve you for breath to maintain the flame of life in your vitals while you spend your life in the service of sin and of Satan and of God's enemies. God's creatures are good and were made for men to serve God with and don't willingly subserve to any other purpose, and they groan when they are abused to purposes so directly contrary to their nature and their end. The wrath of God is like great waters dammed for the present, they increase more and more and rise higher and higher till an outlet is given, and the longer the stream is stopped, the more rapid and mighty is its course when once it is let loose. The bow of God's wrath is bent and the arrow made ready on the string. Justice bends the bow at your heart and strains the bow, and it is nothing but the mere pleasure of God and that of an angry God without any promise or obligation at all that keeps the arrow one moment from being made drunk with your blood. Thus are all you that never passed under a great change of heart. And then I stop here because after that point, it gets rough. He did not raise his voice. He merely took the text from Deuteronomy, "Their foot shall slip in due time." And he showed these people that God was loving, but God was holy. And he was enraged at them. And he held them over hell like a spider. He said, "The boards under you are rotten, and nothing but the sovereign pleasure of God allows you to take one breath to the next to continue your evil ways." That message was so powerful that he would stop and people would begin to shriek. It was as if they could sense perdition upon them. He only gave the message about twice. Well, 300 people were added to his church. And this is a rural church. And you didn't join the church simply by coming forward. You wrote out your testimony as to your conversion. It was such a huge revival that Edwards said that you could go down the streets of any part of the city and you could hear singing in the houses. The youth totally turned around. It was so amazing that he wrote a book called A Narrative of Surprising Conversions at Northampton. And it was so popular that John Wesley had it published in England. People had never seen this. It was the pietist movement that came to America by the sovereign act of God. Well, it's at this point that a lightning rod comes with these breezes in Jersey and these breezes in Philadelphia. This man shows up to preach. Now, there's another fellow. Well, let me just give you this fellow right here. His name is George Whitfield. Billy Graham follows in the heels of a fellow named Billy Sunday. Billy Sunday followed Dwight Moody, who followed Charles G. Finney, and the first of all non-denominational evangelists preaching in the open, calling men to salvation, is this man. He's an actor skilled in Shakespeare, who becomes an Oxford scholar, who becomes a Christian. He lay in his bed under great burning fever, the tale goes, And he remembered that God was the one who said, "Come unto me, drink from the water of life freely." And he cried out in his bed at Oxford, "O God, I thirst, I thirst." And his soul was put at ease. That was his conversion. He begins to do what no man ever did. He said, "I want to go to the common people." And he begins preaching out of doors. He does it in England so well that he makes 7 tours of the United States. And when I say he was the lightning rod, he was. All of the conversation in New Jersey and Pennsylvania, all of the conversation down in the southern colonies, all of a sudden you had this common intercolonial phenomena that everybody knew about called George Whitefield. And they all came to him to hear this man preach. Benjamin Franklin was one of his greatest admirers. Benjamin Franklin documents that you could back up listening to him speak, and you could back up to 1/2 mile away, and you could hear him at a normal preaching voice. That's Mingo Road up into the housing addition, that you could hear this man preach. He preached, documented, to 30,000 people at one time. That's Fouts Field without a microphone. Was the power of his voice. I'm going to read you an account of a man that went to hear him preach. This is firsthand, a fellow named Nathan Cole, a farmer. Just listen to this. "On a sudden, in the morning about 8 or 9 o'clock, there came a messenger and said, 'Mr. Whitefield preached at Hartford and Wethersfield yesterday and is to preach at Middletown this morning. I was in my field at work and I dropped my tool that I had in my hand and I ran home to my wife, telling her to make ready quickly and to go hear Mr. Whitefield preach at Middletown. Then run to my pasture I did for my horse with all my might, fearing that I should be too late. Having my horse with my wife soon mounted, I with my wife mounted the horse and went forward as fast as I thought the horse could bear. And when my horse got much out of wind, I would get down and put my wife on the saddle," nice guy, "and bid her ride as fast as she could and not stop or slack for me, except I bade her, and I would run until I was much out of breath and then mount my horse again. And so I did several times to favor my horse. And we improved every moment to get along as if we were fleeing for our lives all the while, fearing that we should be too late to hear the sermon. We had 12 miles to ride double in little more than an hour, and we went round by the Upper Housen Parish. When we came within 1/2 mile of the road that comes down from Hartford, I saw before me a cloud of fog rising, and I first thought it came from the great river. But as I came nearer the road, I heard a noise, something like the low rumbling thunder, and presently found it was the noise of horses coming down the road, and this cloud was a cloud of dust made by the horses' feet. It rose some rods into the air over the tops of hills and trees, and when I came within 20 rods of the road, I could see men and horses slipping along in the cloud like shadows, and I drew nearer, and it seemed like a steady stream of horses and their riders, scarcely a horse more than his length behind another, all a lather with foam and sweat, their breath rolling out of their nostrils. Every jump and every horse seemed to go with all of his might to carry his rider to hear news from heaven for the saving of souls. It made me tremble to see the sight, how the world was in a struggle. I found a vacance between 2 horses to slip in mine." It's like getting on LBJ, you know. A couple of horses open up and old Nathan slips in there. "And we went down the road. They looked almost of a color, coats, hats, shirts, and horses with the dust. We went down into the stream, but heard no man speak a word all the way for 3 miles, but everyone pressing forward in great haste. When we got to Middletown, old meeting house, there was a great multitude of people assembled together. We dismounted and shook off our dust, and the ministers were then coming to the meeting house, and I turned and looked towards the great river and saw ferry boats running swift backward and forward, bringing over loads of people, and the oars rowed nimble and quick. Everything, men, horses, boats, seemed to be struggling for life. The land and banks over the river looked black with people and horses all along the 12 miles. I saw no man at work in his field. All seemed to be gone. The lightning rod, see, of Whitefield was there. The message of salvation. People had to come and hear what was happening. That's revival. And I saw Mr. Whitfield come upon the scaffold. He looked almost angelic, young, slim, slender youth before some thousands of people with bold, undaunted countenance. And my hearing how God was with him everywhere as he came along, it solemnized my mind and put me into a trembling fear before he ever began to preach. That's revival. This man's heart is broken before Whitfield ever speaks. That's the sovereign act of God. He looked as if he were clothed with authority from the great God, and a sweet, solemn solemnity sat upon his brow, and my hearing him preach gave me a heart wound. And by God's blessing, my old foundation was broken up, and I saw that my righteousness would not save me. Then I was convinced of the doctrine of election. Whitfield preached on the sovereign predestination of God. That was his message. He preached a God of holiness and greatness. There were no altar calls given. He simply would preach, he would thunder, he would hold up men to Calvary. He would say on some occasions, "You are too wicked, being half man and half devil, to weep for yourselves, and so I will weep for you." And Whitfield would weep before the thousands for their souls. He would finish and say, "Your blood is on your heads. I am free from the blood of all men. I bid you good day." There were seen at this time the first occurrence of phenomena. It is documented at times people by the hundreds would collapse through no invocation of Whitfield. They simply would collapse at the recognition of God's presence, and they would go, on some cases, comatose. That is why some people, predominantly a minister from Boston named Charles Chauncey, spoke against the revival because of what was called enthusiasm that appeared to be vulgar. It was so pronounced that in the Congregational church they split. The old light Congregationalists did not like the coming of Whitfield and of Edwards. The new lights said, "This is what we have been praying for." Congregationalists and Presbyterians split over this revival. Well, another fellow began to preach just briefly called Gilbert Tennant. He preached a message. Listen to this. In Pennsylvania, he's the son of William Tennant, and it was called "The Dangers of an Unconverted Ministry." As a matter of fact, this is what the tract looked like that was published by Gilbert Tennant, minister of the gospel in New Braunfels in New Jersey. He ended up at Philadelphia. From Jeremiah 5, "A wonderful and horrible thing has been committed in the land. The prophets prophesy falsely, and priests rule on their own authority." And he thundered to these people about following ministers that kept them, he said, a safe distance from their conscience. And he called for these people to forsake their churches and follow after converted ministers. Gilbert Tennant. These were not necessarily bold men. They simply were men that were born for their day. And they cried out in their day for conversion as they saw the slipping away of their country. In the South, just quickly, this is what amazes me about revival, that God could use a kid that can go to Yale at 13, and then he can use this guy. Samuel Davies, I have on your sheet Morris, that's a misprint. It's Samuel Davies. He is a layman who can't preach, but he can read. And he calls to people in Virginia that was a rural community to come to him, and he would read to them. And he read to them, a lot of them illiterate, he read Pilgrim's Progress. He read the messages of Edwards and the messages of Whitfield, the messages of Wesley. He read Martin Luther's preface to the book of Romans, and he introduced to this entire community, "Ye must be born again by faith in Jesus Christ." He challenged deism. He read the Apologist that challenged deism, and people began converted. The Presbyterians came in, William Robinson, organized them into presbyteries, and then the Baptist took off with a northern congregationalist that got converted, became a Baptist, moved to Sandy Creek, North Carolina, and by 1780, there were 460 Baptist churches in that area. The Baptist church took off in North Carolina and Georgia in the Great Awakening. If you are a Baptist here, The chances are, if you could trace back your heritage, at some point you're going to emerge from the preaching of Shubal Stearns, a converted New England Baptist. Well, what was the result? 200,000 conversions in the churches. One-tenth of the American population was converted. Hundreds of churches begun. Colleges, do you know how many colleges were begun? In Rhode Island, a college of Baptists that is now called Brown University to train Baptist ministers. Whitfield and Benjamin Franklin began a message, or began a ministry that ended up in, they began a college together in Pennsylvania. Today, the University of Pennsylvania was begun because of the heightening of education, because of the Great Awakening. Penn. Moore's Indian Training School. So many Indians trusted Christ that a fellow named Moore began a training school to teach them in the ways of God. Today, it's called Dartmouth University. Princeton University was begun from the Log College. Queens College in New Jersey now is called Rutgers. As a matter of fact, a great many of our New England colleges were begun to train the converts of the First Great Awakening. Well, here's another result of it. You had what was called colonial unity. All the colonies were now united on the phenomena of the awakening. It brought a unity to them. And another thing that happened, now listen to me, this is important. The church-state separation had not been tried since 312 AD, before Constantine. Christians had always wondered, could the Baptist idea of church-state separation and of a church run simply by voluntaryism on the gifts and the commitment of its local assembly, could it run? People said no. Even Edwards didn't believe you could do it. You still gave your tax dollars to the state, and it helped run your church. The thought was, a church can't be separated from the state because it can't run on its own. And if the church falls, the entire community will fall because we have no knowledge of God. The Great Awakening so proliferated the churches that the phenomena of church-state separation, or what Benjamin Franklin called the new order for the ages, became to be a real possibility. A fellow named Isaac Backus, a Baptist minister, was at the Continental Congress and pushed and lobbied for this, and they let him have it. They weren't sure it could work. But the enjoyment we have today of being free from the state came from the Great Awakening. Well, what are the lessons we can learn? That God, number one, can use any kind of person for his purposes. You can be a lay reader. You can be a great preacher. You can be a great thinker. He can even use men of theological divergence. Shubal Stearns was an Arminian. Edwards was a Calvinist. Use them marvelously. The fact that God can start things very insignificantly and gather speed. The idea of great strong preaching, calling men to the standard of holiness, was unheard of at this time. It was considered vulgar. That takes off at the Great Awakening. You know what else becomes phenomenal? The idea of Calvinism. How many have ever thought that if you preach about predestination, you will quell and quench zeal for evangelism? These great early men, Davies, Edwards, Whitfield, are Calvinists. They feel that as they call to the masses, the elect of God will come. Calvinism spurs you to evangelism. Another thing that we learn is the exaltation of the greatness of God, that you don't try to bring people to faith by the carrot of golden streets. You lift up the majesty of God to mirror their own sinfulness, and now they are truly converted and not just humans that are using God to reach their own material ends. They did not call men to heaven. They called them to salvation and the forgiveness of their guilt. Another thing that we learn is that prayer is revival. The way we're going to tell in all of these revivals that God is about to do a great thing is that Christians begin to pray. Does prayer bring revival? No. Prayer is revival. When Christian people become greatly concerned for their having departed from the greatness of their past, the evil of their day, the possibilities of God's power, and they begin to meet and to seek God like the psalmist, "Wilt thou not revive us again, O God, that we might praise thee anew?" That is when God begins to work. Converting the heathen, that is not nearly as big a problem as exciting the saint. We pray this Thursday. First Thursday prayer, Charles, is that right? We meet here at 6, and we pray for the souls of our children. Would you pray with me? Our Father, for the greatness of your name that showed itself in our past, we thank you. For the privileges that we enjoy from that exertion of your mercies, we thank you. For the testimonies of the sovereignty of God of that day, we thank you. But our Lord, though men perish and fail, your word remains. Your position as sovereign king has never, ever been challenged. Could you not revive us again? Our Father, if men and women would weep for their children who simply would walk about at night and engage in bundling, can we not weep for what has happened to our children? If Mr. Edwards would grieve over an uncommon lack of religion in his day, cannot our heart break over what has happened in ours? Or were they of different stuff in that day to pray? Can we not? We who remember perhaps the way things used to be. Our Father, as we study this week and begin to wrap this up and the activity of God on this little piece of land, preserving it from the expedition of evil and providing a place for the gospel to go forth, in our day where this little land has been corrupted, would you give us great insights? And we'll ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen.